we're all gonna die. Increasing concentrations of atmospheric CO2 are causing the ice caps to melt, which will lead to the flooding of all major port cities and a mass exodus towards the middle of the country. This is where we'll eventually run out of space, food, and potable water, causing us to either wage war on one another or succumb to disease. That right there pretty much sums up what I've been told about global warming. We're screwed. It's a lot to take in. It doesn't really seem to encourage any emotion besides fear. So to clear my head from all this negativity, I wandered into the woods. Sat around and figured out that, yeah, we're headed in a dangerous direction. And yeah, we're kind of doing something about it. But it seems like what we're doing right now is sort of sidestepping the problem. Rather than removing the excess CO2 from the atmosphere, we're just reducing the amount that we put into it. So this is where my story begins. While I was messing around in the woods, I heard a voice. It was just the trees and me, so this voice kind of freaked me out. Okay, this was weird. It was like a tree was trying to talk to me.
I have the answer. I have the answer to your problem.
And it was a psychic tree.
It's in the roots, in the roots, in the genes, in the genes, in the genes.
I guess that was it. The answer to our problem was in the trees, in their roots and in their genes. I had to nerd out on this, so I hit the journals. I searched for genes and roots, and the handful of articles that I came up with were all about something called phytosequestration. Apparently, this is something that farmers and biologists are messing with that uses plants to absorb carbon from the atmosphere and deposit it through their roots into the ground. I still had some questions, though, so I headed to the eBio department at the University of Colorado, where Dr. William Adams III, a professor and plant researcher at CU, agreed to sit down with me and answer some questions about this phytosequestration dealio.
So, have you heard of this phytosequestration thing?
I have heard of phytosequestration. I mean, and I think you are referring specifically to the sequestration of carbon dioxide.
Exactly.
Carbon from the atmosphere.
Go on.
So plants, of course, as they grow, they're putting away a lot of carbon.
Interesting. So what happens to this carbon once the plants get a hold of it?
As long as it remains in that organic matter, it's sequestered.
But
as long as it's locked away, especially in soil, then it's kept there. Now, our typical agricultural practices of planting annual crops and then ripping them out and then going back and planting again has done a lot to sort of disturb that sequestration because the soil doesn't get a chance to hold on to that carbon.
That sucks. Speaking of farming, though, I have in my notes that over the last 50 years, crop productivity in agriculture has grown nearly 100%. And for corn, half of this increase was due to genetic improvements. Is there any research being done on the genes that would allow plants to sequester more carbon as biomass?
I don't think there's been much or any research done into increasing the sequestration of carbon by plants through genetic engineering, because there probably isn't that much profit to be gained from it.
Oh, capitalism strikes again. Let's see. Someone said that plant research in the U.S., mostly genetic engineering, is the poor cousin in the biological sciences, receiving less than 2% of the $40 billion life sciences budget. Would you like to see an increase in this?
I would love it if there was more sort of community-funded, government-funded research in all areas of genetic engineering, of crop plants and other things for the benefit of society. But certainly in this country, there is no atmosphere, support for increased taxes.
Nope. Oh, look at that. We're out of time. I'll just let myself out.
My next stop was the office of Lisa Dilling, a science policy expert who's investigating farming techniques like no-till farming, which leaves a crop's root system in place after harvest, allowing for increased sequestration of carbon.
So, what's the deal with carbon sequestration?
So, when you're thinking about increasing carbon sequestration in the soils, you want to focus on processes that prevent prevent that carbon from getting back out to the atmosphere. So.
Cool, cool. How can a farmer prevent that from happening?
Things that farmers have started to do that are pretty effective are things like no-till farming. So no-till farming means, you know, instead of tilling up the soil after you're done with your crop, you just leave it, you know, and you just kind of let the stuff lay on the ground, decompose, and get that material back into the soil.
Right, which improves the function of microbes in the soil. Trust me, would a guy in a bow tie lie to you about soil microbes? I don't think so. Now, why aren't more farmers practicing this no-till method?
You know, farmers are business people, right? They're trying to make a business. They're trying to make a living like anybody. They're not just out there to be altruistic and save the planet, although they often, all the ones I spoke to were very aware of doing the right thing for the land and trying to conserve and trying to leave the land in better shape than they found it. So
farmers need to make money. Interesting.
So I borrowed my buddy's Prius, headed out to eastern Colorado where a farmer named Curtis Sayles is leading the charge for no-till agriculture.
Hey, Kurt. So how does using this no-till farming method help you while at the same time helping the environment?
Well, several ways. You know, we're in the prime Dust Bowl area from back in the 30s, the dirty 30s.
Ha! Dirty 30s. Good one. Sorry. Go on. Dirty 30s.
Well, we've taken it a little bit farther with the no-till, and we have cover on the ground, so we cut down wind erosion, and then by having that stubble or a growing crop there, we're also cutting down on water erosion. Okay?
Okay.
At the same time, because of that intense cropping, we're building our organic matter in our soil. And that's where the carbon sequestration comes in, because that is building that carbon base in the soil.
Right. The more plants you have above ground, the more roots you have below ground. And it's all carbon from the atmosphere. You seem to be a pretty environmentally conscious guy for a farmer. Why is that?
I think there's a misconception that farmers are not environmentally savvy. Now, they may not always know all the good stuff, all right?
All right, what's this good stuff? You talking about the gene that's been isolated that prevents crops from getting contaminated due to drought?
The drought gene will allow me to raise better corn. The better corn that I raise, we've already talked about that's a large biomass plant. The better corn I raise, the more carbon it takes out of the air. And so, you know, I'm accelerating. I'm going to be net taking more carbon out than I'm putting in. So that's a good thing.
That is a good thing. You're going to be making more money because you're going to be growing better corn, all while you're taking carbon out of the atmosphere. Awesome.
Well, there you have it. Researchers in the plant biosciences, while massively underfunded, are isolating genes that can increase crop yields, increase growth rates, and prevent contamination of crops due to drought. At the same time, policy researchers like Lisa Dilling and farmers like Curtis Sayles coming up with methods to improve farming practices that'll increase the amount of carbon sequestered. So, I guess we're not really screwed after all, but you really shouldn't take it from me. I'm just some kid with a camera. You should probably go out, research, hit the journals, Google, whatever you gotta do to educate yourself, make your own opinion. Oh, don't forget to thank a plant.